This is Yesterday USA Live. Here's John, Larry, and Walden.
Hello. Hey, Larry. Carl.
I'm going to fade it because we're now on the air, have been for about 2 minutes, but Carl didn't know that.
That's true.
He's just out of practice, okay. That's all.
Let's get rid of this.
We hear Doris often enough.
Oh, I love Doris Day, though. That's just my...
Yeah, but she doesn't do anything with regard to Kickstarter. So
how do you know? How do you know? Doris Day could donate.
She doesn't do GoFundMe either. How are you, Carl?
Hey, good. How are you, Larry?
I'm good. I'm good. Keeping incredibly busy. I'm in the middle of another meeting now, which will end shortly. So I'll jump in as soon as this is done.
Awesome. Okay. Sounds great.
That mean you're going to save us? Is that what you're trying to say, Larry?
I'm really definitely afraid that I'm going to answer the wrong question in the wrong meeting. Happens. It has happened before.
Well, just promote Kickstarter and the other mean. They understand, right? Yep,
exactly.
Money over there.
So we're to the point in time now where you can give the date and start, Walden, if you want to.
That's a possibility. That would be a novelty, wouldn't it? Monday night, yep. November 6th, 2023. Hello, everybody. I'm Walden Hughes. Over there is Larry Gassman. Over here is Michael Hingson. And we are welcome. It's been a while. Carl Amari, welcome back.
Hey, hi, Walden. Hi, nice to see you again. And Michael, what an honor to meet you. I've never had a chance to meet you yet. This is going to be great.
Well, thank you. The honor is all mine.
Awesome.
I even listened to your Christmas shows in Chicago on Christmas or around there.
Yeah, you're from here, right? You're from
Chicago.
Year.
From Chicago. Yeah. Moved when I was five.
Right.
No internet when I moved, darn, but oh well.
Well, what an unbelievable life you've led, and that's really great to meet you.
Well, one of these days we'll make it back to Chicago to speak somewhere, and I will have to hunt you down so we can.
I would love it.
That would be fun. Yeah,
that
we can talk about Walden.
Oh, you're gonna be a Walden. Yeah, that's true. That's true. Hey, Carl, let's talk about the Kickstarter. I mean, you have had such an interesting career. There's so many stories I think it'd be fun just to talk about besides Kickstarter. But mainly, we're going to hit up the Kickstarter idea. Would the Ziv idea been in the back of your mind for a while? I mean, I know Mike Martini's been sitting with them for a long time. But
yeah.
Have that sort of been a dream and a hope and you just finally cut the deal? Talk about the process of that.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, I did not know about all of the shows were in, you know, donated to Heritage Media. I didn't know about that until about maybe 5 years ago. And I really can't recall how I learned of that. Maybe somebody in the industry told me. And so I reached out to Mike and we met in Chicago and had a great meeting. And I said, look, I don't have the wherewithal to make all those transfers. We tried to figure out how to maybe do it locally there in Cincinnati. But really, if you're going to do it, you have to do it right. You really have to have a professional that does this type of thing. It has to be all cleaned. You know the whole process of cleaning a disc. It's not a short process. You have to have the right style eye. You have to have someone who really understands this really kind of magical process to get the right audio off that. So, it just made sense to license it with the promise that I would try my best to get them transferred, but I would make sure that we did it to the utmost. It really makes no sense to just do it a half-assed. So that was kind of the impetus of the meeting. And it took about 5 years to actually, because there was other companies circling that library. Last year, Mike licensed the entire Ziv library to me, and I'm doing my best and trying my best to get it transferred, starting with Bold Venture.
Did you consider doing Boston Blackie first, or did you know Bold Venture is probably going to be the flagship thing to kick it all off?
Well, you know, my favorite series of all time is Boston Blackie. So I thought, well, yeah, maybe we'll start with Boston Blackie, but that's 218 episodes. And Bold Venture, which was really the crown jewel of the Ziv syndicated radio shows, I think it was the most successful as far as 78 episodes goes. I mean, you know, Cisco Kid, I think, was almost 1,000 episodes. It probably made more money overall for the Ziv Corporation. But as far as if you amortize 78 episodes, I think Bold Venture was the most successful per episode. Plus, you know, there was lots of networks trying to get Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall for years to star in a series, and they always turned it down. But, Frederick Ziv just made them an offer they couldn't refuse. So I always really always have been fascinated with the fact that he was able to land Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall to star in a series. And so I thought, let's start with it because it's manageable. It's 78 episodes. If we can get through Bold Venture, we could kind of gauge what, and obviously learn from this first one, hopefully get the cost down as we do bulk. And that would be the case then with Boston Blackie. I think it would cost less per disc to do the transfer with Boston Blackie, but you know, we were getting our sea legs with Bold Venture.
When you had Real Spirit going, you had a great series, I think, in stores, a Movie to Go, and you syndicated the highway show. Typically, in the old days, and let's face this, it's 30 years ago now. I can't believe it. Hard to believe that. Anyway,
a long time.
Was that typically a good seller? Generally, I'm asking with the Hollywood movie stars in the store. I would think that would have been a good seller, and maybe that would have influenced your mark thinking to go with Humphrey Bogart show first. Or am I
no, wrong? It really wasn't. Lux Radio Theater, believe it or not, never was a really big seller for us. But you know, I've always been fascinated with how they were able to take a 90-minute or 2-hour movie and condense it into 60 minutes, well, actually less than 60 minutes or 30 minutes. I always they always did such an incredible job. And when you listen to Screen Directors Playhouse or Gulf Screen or Academy Award Theater or Lux Theater, and you listen to, let's say, The Maltese Falcon or whatever it was, they did such a great job. And so I thought that would work. Now, this is before podcasts were even, you know, the word podcast, I don't think was even invented back in the days when we were, when I was running Radio Spirits. But it made sense to me to syndicate something and put a talent, you know, I think it was Chris Eric's, it might've been, no, it wasn't Chris Eric's, Leonard Maltin, or I don't know if it was Leonard Maltin or somebody. I can't remember now.
It was the guy who was NBC on the East Coast from Boston.
I'm drawing a blank right now. I'll think of it. But
two in the morning, you will.
Yeah, I'll think of it. But he was a movie. You know, he was kind of a movie expert.
Right.
And we put him on there, and we. I thought it was going to be super successful, but guess what? It wasn't that successful. I think it was called Radio Movie Classics or something like that. We didn't sell a lot of those. But you would, you know, you would think it would be great because it's like a movie for your ears.
Right.
But not our bestseller. You know what was really, you know what sold really, really well was those 60 shows for $60. It was the great, you know, classic radio.
Huh? Why do you think that did so well?
I don't know. I think $60 is a number, you know, almost anybody can afford. You know, it was affordable and you got a lot for $60. You know, it was 60 shows on 20 90-minute cassettes or 30 CDs. And I'm telling you, it blew out. I mean, we had it at Costco and some other Costco was our biggest.
Yeah.
But we had it in some catalogs like Signals and Wireless. I wish Wireless was still around. Boy, that did they move.
Yeah.
Move the merchandise. But yeah, that for some reason that was our biggest seller. The 60 shows for $60. But then when I sold the company in 1998, the new owners came in and were like, oh, we can't give people that many shows for only $60. And they kind of monkeyed with the best thing we had. It was the secret sauce, you know, secret sauce, $60, 60 shows, $60. And they changed it.
Yeah, I remember you had the Walter Cronkite set, which was I went with his name, but must have sold a lot.
It did. Yeah.
Larry King,
and getting to work with Larry Walter.
King, yeah.
What was that?
Yeah, Larry King do one.
No, we never had Larry King, but we had.
Okay. Maybe we had, the previous owner, I guess. Can I have one?
Maybe they had one after me. We had Andy Williams doing a Christmas one. We had, a Cronkite, Walter Cronkite. And that was real fun because I got to go to his house in Martha's Vineyard. And I remember going there with a DAT machine and he was sitting there at his desk with his dog by his feet. And we were talking about, and I gave him a list of all these shows and he picked 60 shows and then did an audio forward on DAT for me. And I remember flying there and saying, oh my gosh, I'm going to get to walk into Walter Cronkite's house. We did one with Ray Bradbury. That was a lot of fun. Bradbury was just, oh my gosh, that might've been the most fun interview I ever did was with Ray Bradbury.
Did you do one with Jack Webb?
Nope. Never met Jack Webb. I wish I would have. No, never.
If you look back upon the history of Radio Spirit Call, what put it on the map? Were there one bigger thing that really helped the company? Were there like when you went on Chicago radio, was it, when you made your first license deal with somebody, was there something that really put the company on the map?
Yeah. Well, that's a great question. It's a fun story to tell because, you know, I was got hooked on these shows as a young kid. I was 12 when I first got into classic radio, and I didn't have any idea how, you know, the magnitude of it, you know, or how important it was, because it's really how people were entertained in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. I mean, sure, there were movies and things like that, but really radio was how everyone, got their news and information and certainly entertainment. And so I learned as I got older about it, and I wanted to do it as a business, not just a hobby. I loved it as a hobby, but I wanted to do it as a business. And so I learned pretty early on because I got a cease and desist letter from Charles Michelson. Charles Michelson sent me a cease and desist letter because I was airing it on a radio station, a small radio station in Chicago. And that kind of opened my eyes to, you know, if I wanted to get into this business in a big way, that I would need to have rights. So I started to inquire about rights and got a few shows under license. And then what really put the company on the map, I had to give you a little of that background, but what really put us on the map, Radio Spirits, was I had a show on Eastern Airlines. You know, they're not around anymore, but I had a show on Eastern Airlines where I was playing these programs, and the senior vice president of CBS heard me on an Eastern flight, called me and said, "We have a show, you may have heard of it, called the CBS Radio Mystery Theater. Hyman Brown is the producer. We have this show on 88 radio stations across the country, all the CBS owned and operated radio stations, and it's going away at the end of the year." Now, this was in like 89 maybe.
Okay, to be
clear. And he said to me, "I'd like to meet with you because I think this is a cool program that you do. And I like the way you, you know, talk about the shows and things like that." And so we met, and he said, "We need to either go back to all news, you know, for this hour, Monday through Friday, or we'll plug something in that you create. And we'll give you all the rights to all of our CBS shows. Suspense, Jack Benny, wow. Gunsmoke, Have Gun Will Travel, Inner Sanctum, you know, On and Let George Do It, on and on and on. All the CBS shows that they own. We'll license this to you. You create a show. We'll put it on the air in replace of, because Hyman Brown didn't want to do mystery theater anymore. And I came up with the name When Radio Was. And I thought, okay, I'm going to be a real famous guy because I'm going to be the host of When Radio Was. And so about maybe 3 weeks before we're ready to go on the air, Dick Brescia, the senior VP, called me and said, "So, Carl, have you figured out who you want to host the show?" And I said, "What? I'm the host." He said, "Are you crazy? Nobody knows who you are. You're nobody. We need a name." And I said, "Well, then I'm not going to do the show. I'm not doing this then." And he's like, "Well, that's fine. You know, you can't copyright an idea. We'll just hire someone else to do it. You sure?" And I had seller's remorse, you know. And I said, "Okay, I'll tell you what. I'll do it, but I want 1 minute of time on the show to promote a catalog. You know, an 800, you know, I want to be able to say, you know, that whoever the host is will say, 'Hey, call this 800 number, get a catalog.'"
Right.
And he said, "Are you insane? Do you know how much money a 1 minute on the CBS radio network would do you realize what you're asking for?" And I said, "Dick, that's my final offer. If you want the show and you want me to produce it, I want a minute of time to promote a catalog." And I said, "And it's going to benefit you guys because I'm going to pay you royalties of everything that we sell. You know, you licensed me all these CBS shows." And, you know, so he called me back about 2 days later, and I was sweating for those 2 days, let me tell you. Called me back and he said, "Okay, you know what? Instead of making the show 54 minutes, make it 53 minutes and just use the other minute for your commercial." So, wow. So the commercial kind of became programming, you know, was part of the programming. Mm-hmm. And that is what put Radio Spirits on the map. Because when I started that show in 1990, 1190, I think was the initial first broadcast. And it was Monday through Friday on 88 stations. I think we were doing maybe $10,000 a year. After the first year, we were doing about $2 million.
Wow.
And then it just doubled and doubled and doubled until it got to about $12 million a year. That was the height in 1998.
You know, you
and who was the first host?
Marketing, Carl. Did you have a background in marketing?
That's what I thought.
Did you have a background in marketing? You were always good about that.
No. No, I did not have a marketing background, but I love these shows, you know, and I just, these shows are an education, you know, there's every genre, there's, and you know, you just, when you fall in love with something like I did with these radio shows, and it's been my life. I mean, these shows and producing the audio Bibles that I've done over the years in a radio drama format have been my career. I mean, I've done produced some movies and things like that, but really I've done more with, I think, radio I've never not been on the radio since 1981, when I first started in college. I've been on the radio for 42 years straight.
Isn't it nice to be able to take a passion and make it your vocation?
Yeah, it's been a blessing.
You've got the best of both worlds.
Yeah, it's been a wonderful ride. And, you know, there's not a day, and I really mean this, there's not a day that goes by that I don't listen to these shows. And, not only in my work, but just in my pleasure, because if I'm in my car driving, I'm listening to them. And I'd rather listen to classic radio than watch TV or read a book or anything.
Well, radio has such an interesting ambiance in a lot of ways. We've actually talked about it here. When you look at radio, when you listen to radio, when you listen to radio during World War II, especially, and you contrast it with everything that we see going on in the media today, there was such unanimity and there was such support. Everyone came together. The radio brought the world together. They brought Americans together. And now none of that occurs. And people, I think, really miss what radio can still contribute, but certainly did contribute back in the 40s and 50s.
And I think that's why, you know, like your show and other people's radio shows are almost more popular than ever. I know my show, you know, Hollywood 360, we're on almost 200 radio mm-hmm. stations. And I kind of gauge, a lot of the stations don't subscribe to ratings and things. So it's tough to know exactly how many or even guess how many people are listening. But we have an idea, you know. But I gauge the listenership by how many emails and texts I get and things. And it's never been more than it is in the last few years. It seems to me that what is really interesting about it is there's almost nobody today. I mean, a very small portion of the people listening to my show or your show actually heard these programs mm-hmm. back True. In the day. So True. You would think, oh, they're kind of waning. They're not waning. And I think that that's so interesting that they're becoming even maybe not more popular, but there are more people listening to them now than there were maybe 20 years ago. Certainly when they were on the radio, you had millions and millions of people. But I'm saying since they've been gone, since the 60s, I think they're more popular now than they were in the 60s and 70s and 80s and 90s.
And we all thought that it was going to go the other way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We figured, but people relate. They relate to the shows. Yeah. They relate to everything that goes on. I mean, and look, on top of everything else, you've even got Sirius XM that has Greg Bell, but he also has played When Radio Was. Yeah. And the internet makes a big difference. A
huge difference.
Yeah. No, yeah. There's without a doubt. And the people that contact us, and we're on American Forces Radio too. We're every naval ship at sea is listening to this. So we get a lot of texts and a lot of emails from servicemen and women. And it's just such an honor to entertain people with these shows and introduce people to these shows. Because a lot of the people, as I say now, listening, never heard On a Country Road mm-hmm. or never heard, you know, Country of the Blind or, you know, these shows that are like these unbelievable programs. You know, there's obviously the ones that stand out. Sorry, Wrong Number and
Three Skeleton Key.
Three Skeleton Key, yeah. These shows, we all have heard them many, many times, but a new listener, remember when you first heard, you know, do you remember when you first heard Sorry, Wrong Number or On a mm-hmm. Country Road? I remember, and it blew me away.
Yeah, I remember. It was on Suspense. I was listening. I was a kid. I forget what date it was exactly, but it was in the late 50s on Suspense. They did another remake of it, and it was great.
Yeah. I mean, the other day for, you know, during October on Hollywood 360, we play all, you know, Halloween shows. And we do the same thing with holiday shows through December, you know, Christmas program. And I recently got a copy of August Heat, and I think it was from Joe Webb, but it was in perfect sound. Like the, my August Heat, which I think is one of the best episodes of Suspense ever. Mm-hmm. And I remember there was an album that came out. I think maybe Radiola Records put it out years ago, and I had it, and it was okay quality, but I got a hold of this, and I think it was from Joe, and I was just like, oh my goodness, listen to this. You know, you can hear Ronald Coleman kind of breathing on this show, right? So it was so much fun to play that for my listeners, because I remember first hearing that and being so blown away by it, and it wasn't even that great a quality. So I could just imagine how much more impactful it was hearing it in that sound.
Do you do a lot of remastering of shows to improve quality?
No, you know, I don't. What you know, with the club, I have a club called the Classic Radio Club. We just take the shows, you know, the what we put in the club, we have to. It has to come from a disc, so that's like the that's like a either or tape. You know, sometimes these were all on they were on tape, so they have to come from either, you know, direct from the disc or tape, or as super low a generation as possible. Mm-hmm. And then my engineer just does a very, very light declick. But I don't really like processed. Mm-hmm. I don't really like to have a noise reduction because I think it muddies the sound. I'd rather have it be more brilliant, you know, even if there's a little bit of sound. I don't think people mind a little bit of surface noise if the quality is there.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep, because generally what they wind up doing is they cancel out the high end, and they usually overdo it. And
yeah.
I'd rather not have it if I had a choice. And you can, if you're really careful, you can get rid of small disc sounds.
But generally
they don't do that, and I'd rather have it more like what it sounded like, if possible. Because then you get the full spectrum.
Mm-hmm. Audio. Exactly. Yeah. I don't mind a little surface noise if I'm hearing that, you know, the real, like the lows and the highs and the, you know, and it's real clean. So yeah, that's what we put in the club. You know, everything in, you know, there's 10 shows every month plus a booklet that Carl Shadow helps me write. So it, you know, I write it and Carl corrects everything. You know, he's great. And and so when people get the club CD, you know, it's 5 CDs in a case with a booklet every month when they join. I make sure that they're getting 10 shows that are just supreme quality. When they pop them in the CD player, it's like, I want them to say, wow, you know, like, wow. Because I remember collecting back in the 70s and 80s and getting things from Radiola and Murray Hill and places like that. And, you know, the quality was decent, but not like what we have today. And I think that's another reason why it's really more popular today than it was in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s.
You were so good about, you're the first one I can think of, Carl, doing the packaging with the booklets. And that was sort of your first thing. I think, you know, Golden Note guys had really nice looking record album, you know, covers, but I think you're the first one I can think of with a booklet and everything. Am I wrong?
Anthony Tolan would write these books. If I picked up the album, I get a hernia. I mean, they were huge.
Yeah. And I just always thought it was kind of fun to know the history, right?
Yeah.
Of these shows, and you put the album out, like for instance, and we all have heard this episode, Murder Castle, right? Uh-huh. on Lights Out, which I just found a Marty Halperin had a copy. I sent it to me on a DAT years ago, and I sent it to Corey, and Corey just did a transfer, and I just got it, and it's like, I cannot believe the quality of this Murder Castle. I've been trying to find Lights Out, Murder Castle in great quality forever, and I had it on a DAT. So, but I don't have a DAT player. So, as far as the booklet, now there's so much history, and you probably know that was based on H.H. Holmes, America's first serial killer. And so what better way to have like that, that episode and then have a booklet where you dot, you know, where it talks about this, you know, H.H. Holmes, you know, we had this murder castle and then Arch Obler did that radio show based on that. But people wouldn't know that if there wasn't a booklet.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Did you license Hyman Brown stuff? I mean, I imagine the family, let's face it, Hyman didn't need the money. So I imagine it was tough. Did you ever consider trying to license CBS Mystery Theater at all?
Yeah, I have. And I've not been successful.
Yeah.
I have had some fruitful conversations, in fact, even recently, mm-hmm. but it's kind of a web, you know,
yeah.
with that show. I don't know if that'll ever come out. I hope it does. If I don't put it out, I hope somebody does, because man, I grew up listening to that. I mean, I was in my bed with the covers, mm-hmm. you know, 10 o'clock at night and couldn't wait for E.G. Marshall and that creaking door.
Yeah. Yeah.
One of the things that I have found with some of the CBS Mystery Theaters that I recorded myself off of the radio, what made them even more fun was they were from KNX. And before the show, they had a newscast, a 5-minute newscast with the teletype in the background. So you heard the news with the teletype in the background, and then it went to the Mystery Theater. They were fun.
Yeah.
I'll tell you a funny Mystery Theater story. When I was a kid listening to these shows, I wrote a letter to Hyman Brown, you know, handwritten letter to him. And I got a return letter from him. It was pretty interesting because he actually took, this was so crazy. He took my envelope and he sliced it and he flipped it inside out. And then he wrote his own letter back, a long letter. I mean, like a long handwritten letter. But I remember getting my envelope back inside out.
That's and unique.
Yeah. And so I had written him a letter saying, I want to be an actor someday. I was probably 14 years old. And I said, I want to be an actor someday. And so could I come to New York and could I be in your Mystery Theater stories, you know? And he said, well, we only use, you know, AFTRA, this and that. And he was very, very kind. And so I got that back. And then years later, when Radio Was took over for the Mystery Theater, that the gentleman that I mentioned earlier, Dick Brescia, who had greenlit that series originally, and greenlit CBS Mystery Theater on CBS and then hired me to replace it because Hyman didn't want to do it anymore. He arranged a dinner for me, and I got to go meet Hyman. I went to his home. He lived in this amazing penthouse in New York, like in Great White Way. He had literally just, I mean, artwork like you could not believe on the walls everywhere, including the bathroom. There was like, I remember going to the washroom and looking at a Monet, you know, Wow. And so there was all these, he was a big, big, big art collector. And so then we went to dinner and I just had the most fascinating dinner, hearing about how he invented, you know, how he created Inner Sanctum and the door and everything. And so that's kind of, you know, what I just, I'm the most, just lucky because I came into this sort of hobby and business right at the tail end, but all these guys and gals were still around. So yes. I got to meet so many of them and interview so many of them and license these shows from so many of them.
It's funny.
Remember the first show you licensed? You mentioned that you licensed a few. Remember the very first one?
Or the first show I ever licensed was Mel Blanc's Fix It Shop from Noel Blanc.
Wow.
And then the second was the Burns and Allen show from George Burns. And Noel introduced me to George. And then George introduced me to Jerry Lewis and Milton Berle and, you know, on and on and on and on. So I never met Jack Benny because Jack Benny had passed away by the time I got into the hobby. But I, you know, met, you know, so many of these people, you know, that created these shows over the years, you know, hundreds.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Larry. I'm sorry. I think I stepped
on you. No, go ahead.
Well, Michael has enjoyed so much your Twilight Zone show. What made you decide to take that at the shot to taking a TV series and bring it to audio? Were there any other shows under consideration, or did you really thought the Twilight Zone was the show to go for?
Yeah, well, how that happened was I'd never thought I would sell Radio Spirits. It never even entered my mind. But, you know, in 1998, I was on the cover of Inc. magazine. Inc. did a cover story on me because we were having such big growth every year. And so 2 years in a row was Inc. magazine. It was in Inc. 500 fastest growing privately held companies. And if you make it 2 years in a row, they'll do a cover story on you. So I was very flattered. They did a cover story on me. And then all of a sudden I was inundated by public companies that wanted to buy my private company. And so I had been doing it. I loved it. But, you know, I also had a passion for going and creating. I wanted to start creating like movies and TV shows and also radio and Bible product and stuff like that, like things that I did after I sold the company. And I got an offer from a big public company in 1998. They kind of, I stayed like face and email continued. Like I was still the face of the company, even though I was no longer with the company after 1998. And so I went on to do things. I produced a couple of audio Bibles with great actors in them and things, a couple of movies. And then I said, you know, I have a great relationship with CBS and they own the Twilight Zone. And I remember growing up watching the Twilight Zone and thinking, you know, these are amazing stories, but you can see the zippers, you know, on these costumes of the Martians and things. I think these stories would work better on radio because I truly believe, and I think we probably all believe, that it's better on radio than any other medium. So I thought it would be really cool to redo that series and update it and make them longer because Twilight Zones were like 22 minutes. I thought it'd be fun to do them like double the time, 45 minutes, and hire actors today and do what like I always had such a envy for but in a good way, you know, like I was always envious of like the Hyman Browns and the Norman Corwins and stuff because they got to actually create these shows, and I thought that would be really fun to do. And so I pitched CBS on the idea of letting me have those stories, the Twilight Zone, and I would hire a great host, and I did with, you know, Stacy Keach,
right?
And you know, cast, and I built a studio. I built like a whole Foley stage and sound studios and everything, and you got all Neumann microphones and and had a whole thing just for that. And I would do we would do like two shows. I would have a star fly in to the studio, and they'd stay a couple of days, and we'd order food, you know, we'd do a round table. We'd all like be eating around the round table. And then it was sort of like how they probably did it back in the day, you know, and then we would go in the studio and kind of scrub through it, but we didn't do the Foley at that time. I don't know how they did that. It's just magical when you think about how they pulled it off. I wasn't that good. So I just said, let's just lay all the voice tracks down. And then we'll go back and build it, you know. Technology today, you can do that. And so, yeah, that was from 2001 until about 2008. So maybe 7 years, 8 years. I did all 156 of the original. And then they let me do about 20 new stories, which was a lot of fun, too. So about 175, I think I did in that time.
So have you ever thought of, or would there be any possibility of doing more of those?
Yeah. I mean, what I would really like to do is podcast them. And I'm talking to CBS about it. And what I would do, what I'm pitching them is to is to take the television show, right? So let's say the Burgess Meredith Time Enough at Last, right?
Yeah.
And to actually break it all down. Like, so I would be on with maybe an expert. Like, there's several people that are real experts on the Twilight Zone, you know, like Mark Scree or somebody, and maybe like have a banter about like, well, how about, you know, and then play audio clips from the TV show, right? For the first maybe 7 to 10 minutes, and then say, okay, and talk all about behind the scenes and the director, you know, there's all these, so much information about those shows, who wrote it, what he went on to do or she went on to do, and the music and all this. And then to say, okay. And then, you know, I'm like talking with that expert. And then I say, okay, well, in 2005, you know, we brought in Jason Alexander and he played this role, or I don't know if it was Jason on that one. It might've been Tim Kazurinsky. And I remember now, I think it was Tim Kazurinsky. And then we did this radio version of it, or, you know, and then play it. And that's the podcast. So it's like an hour, you know, where it's like maybe 10 or 15 minutes breaking the TV show down with clips and then playing the actual radio. I think that could be a really interesting mm-hmm. weekly podcast.
I think it would be as well. We had a discussion a couple of days ago here about X-1, which is of course another network, but the discussion we had was, why didn't it last longer? Because X-1 went from 55 to 57 or 58. But it didn't really last all that long. And there certainly was a lot of good science fiction.
Oh, for sure. That was a great series. I mean, Dimension X lasted even
less. Dimension X.
Yeah. You know, and that was first, you know. Yeah. And I mean, those are two great series. I love those series. I mean, like, I remember listening to, as a kid, buying a cassette from, I think it was Nostalgia something or other. And I got a cassette and it had Tunnel Under the World. Remember that one?
Yes.
Yeah. And I remember being frightened, you know, like listening to it in the dark and thinking, oh my gosh, you know, just like, it wigged me out, you know, that show. And so it's just, the theater of the mind is so powerful, right? It's such an incredibly powerful, you know, canvas. It's so cool. That's, I just, these shows are the best.
Did you ever consider taking the Bible series and making, like, you know, like the greatest story that ever told, that famous radio series? Did you ever consider doing that with the Bible recordings ever, Carl? Or is it always going to be an audio?
I did after I did Twilight Zone, I did all those, you know, and then did about 20 new ones. Then I got into the next 4 years of my life was spent on taking the entire Bible. I started with the New Testament, but taking the entire Bible, and creating this really rich, fully dramatized, with hundred there. I think I had about 500 or 600 actors, about 50 celebrities, you know, like Richard Dreyfuss and John Voight and Max von Sydow and Marissa Tomei and Michael York and John Rhys Davies and all these incredible. Jim Caviezel played Jesus in it. You know, he was Jesus in the Passion. And I did a Bible, took me 4 years to do. It was 98 hours long.
Yeah. That one actually came out on Audible as well.
Yeah. And it's Word of Promise.
Word of Promise Bible. Right.
Yeah. And I did that. And that was, I mean, really and truly, it's the only thing that I would say I'm probably the most proud of, that, you know, because what was so interesting is when I decided to do it, I thought, well, are actors going to come to this? You know, are these Hollywood actors going to want to be in it? Are they going to, you know, because like, are they going to think, oh, this is going to hurt their career? Or are they going to, am I going to have to beg these actors? But as soon as I started doing it, and I signed Jim Caviezel to play Jesus in it, and I had a couple of other actors, I think Marissa Tomei as Mary Magdalene, And then all of a sudden, it was like my phone never stopped ringing from agents saying, well, Sean Astin wants to be in it, and Michael York wants to be
in it.
Yeah. You know, and John Rhys Davies and Max von Sydow and Richard Dreyfuss. And I remember talking to Richard Dreyfuss, and I said, well, what role do you want to play? He says, well, I'm a Jewish scholar, and I've always wanted to do something like this. You know, I want to be in the Old Testament. And I said, well, how would you like to play Moses, you know? And I said, because Moses in the Bible did not have a strong speaking voice.
Right.
You know, he was actually had, they even like allude to, he might've had a speech impediment or something. He was not a great speaker, yet God chose him to be his mouthpiece. You know, I said, you're not Charlton Heston. Let's put it to you that, you know, that way. He's like, you know, I cannot believe you're asking me to play Moses, because that has been my dream to play Moses. And I would love to do it. And he worked so hard on it. And Gary Sinise, as David. And I mean, like, I remember Gary Sinise, he was doing NCIS at the time, and he'd say, Carl, I have an hour break and, you know, my lunch break today, you know, on NCIS. I can run over there and do a half hour for you today, and maybe in a half hour for you Wednesday. You know, these actors all came to it, and I wasn't able to pay them, you know, a lot of money, because it was there's so many people in it. They were doing it for just a little bit over scale, and everyone was calling me. So that's why I really am very, very proud of it, because I know it saved a lot of souls. I mean, when you read on Amazon what people, you know, say about it, and how they were at the lowest time of their life, and then they bought Word of Promise, and it helped them, you know, get through losing a child or this or that. I read those sometimes when I'm bummed out about something. I'll read that and I'll say, this thing has helped so many, you know, so many people and saved so many souls. So I'm really proud of it.
It's the best version of the Bible I have ever heard.
Did you have to put a studio in California because of that, Carl, or did you do it all?
And thank you for that compliment, by the way, Larry. I never owned a studio in California. I have a studio here in Chicago area, but we used margarita mix out there. That was like, I asked a couple of the actors, well, where do you normally do your voiceover stuff for movies? And they said, oh, margarita mix, you know. So I just used them, and it was convenient, and most of the actors knew where that was. But it was crazy. I mean, like, I remember recording Max von Sydow in like Nice, France, and, you know, John Rhys Davies he lives in like the Island of Man or something like that. I mean, we recorded in getting like them to a studio, you know, shuttling them to a studio here and there. It was crazy. So I took 4 years to do that project.
But it was a great job. And I'm glad that you're still getting great reviews of it. As I said, I found it on Audible and loved it. And listened to it a lot on airplanes when I fly somewhere to speak. It's a lot of fun to listen to, and it's just such a great production.
Thank you so much.
Carl, do you have a story about, did you ever get a tape erase? You're recording all these people for the Bible. Were there ever any goof?
No, there was never a goof, but I remember, but there was one actor that was playing God and he was voicing the role of God. And we were recording him at Abbey Road Studios in London. And it was very, very expensive to do that, obviously. And I had to be up at a different, you know, obviously like early in the morning to record them there and all this. And he said to me one day, you know, we were recording, he was doing a little bit of it, and and I said, well, I need a little bit more, you know, from you here on this take or this take. And he goes, you know, I'm just not feeling it today. And I'm like, you're God, you need to feel it, you know?
It was pretty funny. Gosh, but
yeah,
you know, it was just, it was so, it was such an interesting 4 years, I got to tell you. I mean, it was a lot of work, and it was it was long days. And I remember I had several assistants because of all the shuttling people in, because we would offer transportation a lot of times, you know, for the actors and things. We couldn't pay them a lot, but we tried to treat them, you know, in a way that they're used to, and cater in food for them and things, you know, cause they're there a long time. So it was a lot of that, you know, because with these actors, they're great if, you know, but they are used to a certain level. Mm-hmm. And as long as you can do that for them, they're great. You know, they're great. I never had any issues with any of the actors on that project.
Couldn't get James Earl Jones to be God, huh?
No, I would have loved to. I would have loved to. But
I mean,
it
would have been very appropriate for him to say, I am your father. But that's another story.
You know, Michael York worked the most because he's the narrator.
He looks great. Yes.
Yeah, the narrator. And he is the sweetest man. He is just the nicest, sweetest man you ever want to meet. And he just worked so hard on that project. Oh, my gosh.
He did a great job.
Yeah, he really did. Thanks.
What is the nicest thank you note you ever got going back to the old time radio day? Was there something from a little kid from a mom and dad who said any really heartwarming thank you notes over the years?
I get a lot of them. People send, you know, I just had someone the other day called me and said, my mom passed away last month. And, you know, we lived together. I was taking care of her. I'm lonely and pretty lonely now without my mom. But we on Saturday night, we would make dinner. We'd make coffee. We'd sit up and we'd listen to the show together. And I just want to thank you for all these years that I got to be with my mom listening to the show, you know, because this show's been on 16 years, Hollywood 360. I get letters like that or calls. And, you know, it's so rewarding. The other day, because my engineer, I nicknamed him Mike Bubble Bath Costello, because I say he's cleaning these discs in the bubble bath all the time, because there's so many of these shows he's cleaning. And, you know, it's like this. And somebody the other day sent two bottles of Mr. Bubble, sent two bottles of Mr. Bubble to him. And I said, look what you got in the mail here, Mike. I mean, listeners, they're just so kind and so sweet.
Back to the Kickstarter project, Carl, what's the best way people can help here from this point on? Because we're down to about 2 weeks to go, right?
Yeah, we have 2 weeks to go. We're about halfway there. So, you know, I don't know if we're going to make it. I sure hope we do, because if we can get through Bold Venture, we're going to release Boston Blackie, but we'll do it in three batches. And I know we're going to be able to charge less because we've got our sea legs now. We could probably do this for about 20 to 25% less. But the way Kickstarter works is once you lock in that number, that's it. If you don't hit the number, it's all or nothing. So the best way to help us get to the funding goal is to pledge sooner rather than later, because I've had people say that if you're within 5,000 or so, we'll up our you know, we'll double or triple our number. So if we can just get real close to our funding goal, I think we'll make it, but we still have 50% of the way and we only have four 2 weeks. But the easiest way to go there and just read all about Frederick Ziv. There's some great articles there, and there's some video, and there's obviously a way to pledge. And the people that pledge will get the shows. So you not only are helping save that series, and then we can move on to to Boston Blackie. And then from there, I Was a Communist for the FBI, Philo Vance, Cisco Kids, for the other ones. And you're going to get the shows in pristine sound. Doug Hopkinson is doing the transfers, and he's amazing. Oh my gosh. I mean, he did one show and I listened to it, and it's like, you can hear Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall breathing, you know, by the microphone. It's amazing what he can do with the right style eye and the sonic cleaning and all that. But in order to help and to get those shows based on your pledge, just go to your search engine, Google or whatever, and just type in Bold Venture Kickstarter, and it'll take you, and you'll just click right to our site, Bold Venture Kickstarter.
And of course, you hear Carl show here every Sunday. Now, if they wanted to follow Hollywood 360, do you have a website just devoted to that show?
Yeah, Hollywood360Radio.com, Hollywood360Radio.com. And we post our schedule, what we're going to play there. And
a monthly newsletter there?
Yep, that's all free.
Plus other emails as well. It's not just other stuff. I get stuff all the time from you.
Yep. There's all kinds of stuff at Hollywood360radio.com. And we'd love you to check it out and obviously help us get to this funding goal on the Kickstarter thing would be incredible. And I thank you so much, guys.
You're welcome.
You get to have Beverly Horseman on in a couple of weeks, so I'm glad that could all work out.
Before you go, what's your next project though that you do have planned, or can you talk about it yet?
Yeah, I have a movie in development that I think we're going to shoot next year. It's a true story set in the 70s in Chicago, and it's really really interesting. I actually was this project was optioned from me about 10 years ago by Clint Eastwood's company, and he didn't make it. Like he'll option a lot of things at once, and it was one of several things that he had optioned, and I thought, oh man, we're gonna make this movie with through Clint Eastwood's company. It never got made. I took it back and turned around, and so I have it, and I have a whole production team and everything. We're just closing in on we're not going to theatrically release it. We're going to do it through like a Netflix or an Apple or something. So we're talking to those kind of companies, but we can't have anybody read it right now because there's a strike, as you know. So we've got it all ready to go. We're ready to package it. We have a couple of actors attached from prior to the strike, but we still need to fill in a couple more roles. And if it goes, then we're going to produce that movie in the winter, like this time next year, because we need snow in Chicago. So we would start maybe in October, and then we'd shoot through January because there's scenes that need snow. So, but it's a mob movie. It's a lot like Casino or Goodfellas, but it's a true story. It's very cool.
So it's being done by Falcon Pictures?
No, it's actually being done by Retro Entertainment, which is my film, film division. But we have some great actors in it, and a great director, and a great writer. That's kind of, I'm hoping it happens. But the radio show is always number one, you know, doing that every Saturday night. And then the podcast, Radio Rarities. Those are week in, week out, you know, type of things.
Now, what about the Christmas season, Carl? Are you still doing something on WGN for Christmas or what?
Yeah. Every Sunday night I do a 2-hour, unless it's preempted by sports, I do a 2-hour show for WGN Radio called WGN Radio Theater. And hopefully I'll do another 24-hour Christmas special for them. It lets everybody take off, you know, for a day or two. I don't do live, that I tape. but I just did a 5-hour Halloween show on Halloween night, and I did that live, and that was a lot of fun. I love doing the WGN show here, because growing up in Chicago, you know, that's the station I listened to. Sure. That was the Cubs station, and to have a show on that station is just such a thrill. You know, such a thrill.
That's cool. Well, we'll listen again this year.
Any other question, Mike or Larry?
Nope, just a big thank you. It's a good...
This has been fun. Well, yeah, actually, before you go, so where are we with the Kickstarter campaign at this point and the whole issue of Bold Venture?
Well, if we can get... I think we're going to need about another 150 people to pledge on average, because we've got about 170 people, I think, that pledged, and we're like halfway there. So if we can get a maybe another 150 people, but it's going to be tough because there's only 2 weeks left. So if here's the great thing: if you pledge, and we don't hit our goal, it doesn't cost you anything.
Right.
So if you pledge, and we do hit our goal, then yes, then we would, you know, the Kickstarter will cash your Visa or whatever, but you'll get the shows. So you'll get them either on 39 CDs in perfect sound or digital downloads of all 78 shows, or you can get both. You know, there's also a level where you get the digital downloads and the CDs. Mm-hmm. But so everyone listening, help us save Bold Venture. If we are successful on that, we will then do Boston Blackie in three batches. We'll do the first like 72 episodes, the next 72, and then another like 73, because there's 218. I mean, can you imagine Boston Blackie?
Yeah.
It's my favorite show. And there's probably, you'd know this better than I, but I think there's maybe about 130 or 140 in circulation. Maybe a third of those are in really good sound. The rest are kind of not so good.
Mm-hmm.
This is all 218 Dick Calamar run in perfect sound directly from Ziv's personal discs that were never played. So like everyone would get all 218 episodes in perfect sound of Boston Blackie. That's the next one we'll go to if we can get through Bold Venture. So, and again, you'll get all the Bold Venture shows. And I think there's about 18 episodes that are not even in circulation of the Bold Venture, because I think there's about 50 some odd shows and about 18 that are not even in anyone's collection.
60 and then another 18.
Yep. You're better at math than I am.
No, I just remember how many shows we used to have in the 70s and 80s. And we've gained a lot over the last few years, but there are still about 18 to 20 missing.
Yeah. And imagine they'll all be the same quality.
Right.
Perfect. You know, they'll all be perfect sound. So, if you can go to just Google or search Bold Venture Kickstarter pledge. And if we hit our goal, then obviously, you'll get those shows. So we want everyone we want to save the series, and then we want to move on to Boston Blackie.
Yep.
But thank you for that. Appreciate it.
Carl, thanks for being with us. It's been a while since we hooked up.
Yeah.
And enjoyed it tremendously.
Yeah, don't wait 5 years to have me come back again. Gosh. It's like I'm grayer and grayer each time I come back.
Well, every time we do your
show... We don't see that, though. This is radio, Carl.
Every time we do your show, the response is incredible. Kind of like when we were doing this with Chuck Shea and the phones would ring off the hook, and that wasn't anything to do with us. It was the vehicle. It was the old radio programs that people loved and wanted to know more about. And at that time, we were involved heavily with Spurtvac, and they wanted to and joined Spurtvac. So... Again, it's the radio shows that are enticing.
Well, good thing, Carl. In 20 years from now, your kids and grandkids will be hosting the show with you. So I hope so.
Yeah.
You guys, listen, what you guys do, I mean, God bless you, because, you know, if it wasn't for people like you, these shows would have been forgotten. You know, what you've done with Spurtvac, mm-hmm. and in all your efforts, and Yesterday USA and everything. You know, Bill Bragg was just a sweet man.
Mm-hmm.
Such a wonderful guy. Mm-hmm. It's too bad he's gone now. But, man, he was a wonderful guy. And there's so many great people in this hobby. And it's just so incredible what you guys are doing, and please keep up the great work you're doing a real service for people.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
It's a lot of fun.
worthwhile. All worthwhile.
Yep.
And we hope we can do this again here on Boston Blackie when we get to that point.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. I hope so.
Yep.
Thanks, you guys. And Michael, hey, it was great. And Michael, when we're on, hopefully we'll be on again because I have a 9/11 story that I want to tell you.
Well, we should just chat offline. We'll work it out.
Okay. Thanks, guys.
Thanks,
okay.
Carl.
Take care.
Okay. God bless you.
God bless. You. Bye.
Carl Amari on Yesterday USA Monday evening. About an hour we kept him, which was good. That was fun. That was enjoyable. And we're probably going to play some shows now. John is not back yet, but he will be soon.